Hi everyone, it's Plastic EP here from Melbourne, Australia, and direct from Orange County in California. I got my biggest guest here. It's Ron McNeil. Yes, you recognize him from the Fab Four. Yes, you recognize him as John. And yes, you recognize him as one of the biggest monkeys collectors in the world and beetle collector too. This is the man. How are you today, Ron?
Doing good. It's great to see you, Plastic. Let me tell you, you don't have to yell. I know you're in Australia, but you don't have to yell. Sorry. It's okay. I can hear you good.
It's all the excitement. Now, Charles, our friend Charles Rosen, has come on and said 100% better.
Good, good. I love it. Hey, Charles, I wouldn't have gone to Liverpool without him.
We love the guy.
Yep.
I know I've got a good interview when he actually takes time to actually watch it live.
I think I paid him to show up, so don't worry about that.
Okay, that's all right. Now, listen, I want to ask you now, with the Fab Four, we've got to say hello to everybody. I want you to say their names and give them a big hello because I know how important you are there in the Fab Four.
Oh, no. Well, yeah, they'll hate me if I don't say hi to them at least. Gavin plays George Harrison, Gavin Pring from Liverpool. Artie, my partner in crime, Artie Saraf, plays Paul McCartney, which you had on a show earlier, which was pretty cool. Adam Hastings out there in England, staying warm. And Joe Bologna Jr., Joseph Bologna, playing Ringo. And that's our current lineup. I'm sort of in retirement. You know, we looked all around to find someone who could play John Lennon, and we met Adam and just said, there you go. We're good. We're good to go.
He's the man. Ron, I just got to ask you to come a little bit more in frame.
Sure.
I just got you to one side there. You just come in the middle there. That's it.
Because
you got to keep the fans happy because you're the pin-up boy.
They're going to see the other side, my other ear here.
No, that's great. You know, Artie, I saw his live concert yesterday. The guy's great. We had a great interview with him. He's
Who's
funny,
that?
Too. Artie.
Oh, Artie. He's all right.
I've interviewed him, but he told me all about you. He said, you're the monkey man. And I said, yeah, he's the one. Got to get him on. Now, you worked with Mickey for 1 year, yeah?
Yeah. Andrew Sandoval put a show together called 50 Summers of Love back in 2017. And we had, Mickey. And we also had Mark Lindsay from Paul Revere and the Raiders. And it was a blast. I had a good time. We played, Beatles, Monkees, and Raiders. What else could you ask for? It was a blast for me. A dream come true for me.
Well, another thing is I've just interviewed Ann Moses. And
yeah.
She was the main writer and editor of Tiger Beat. And she's got a new book called Meow. That's the one. Can you hold that up for us? And if you look closely, then you'll see a picture of Mark Lindsay on the right-hand side there.
Yeah.
He's wearing a caveman outfit. Have you read the book?
I'm right in the middle of it.
And tell me how great the book is, because I'll be sending this to Anne.
Oh, it's fantastic. I mean, like you said, she was in the center of it all. Every teenage girl's dream to be, editor for one of those magazines. And All the Monkees and Raiders and Beatles and all those guys were all on that thing. I'm enjoying it very much.
And I got to tell you, she's a role model to young women at that time because no one knew about these pop stars unless you had someone like Anne that actually physically went there.
Oh yeah.
And chased them and did the interview. And did you know that she actually went on tour with Paul Revere and the Raiders?
Oh yeah. Well, I haven't got to that part yet, but it's part of the story for sure.
You know, I got to say, Anne, we love you. You're rock and roll royalty. Even Ron knows that, don't you, Ron?
Oh, yeah, for sure.
You know, I can't wait till we do our next episode, which will be David Cassidy. He'll be into that one, too.
Yeah, for sure. That's funny.
Getting back to monkeys now. Tell me some of your stories with Mickey, because, you know, he's a great singer. There's no question. Someone told me he was warming up, and he was singing operetta. He was singing a monkey song like operetta or Beatles song in operetta.
Oh, yeah. Well, when you think about it, he's one of the best pop singers of all time. Certainly of the 60s. You got Lennon, McCartney, you got Mickey, and the Stones and all those people. But Mickey, to me, I don't know, it's hard to explain. Like, he could do the rock and roll stuff, the gritty stuff. He could do the really high stuff. He could do the soft stuff. His range is just amazing. And his vocal talents are kind of like, I think somebody said at one time, very dramatic. Like he's almost acting when he's singing as well. Like he's getting so much into the lyrics that you really feel, like Stepping Stone and some of those stuff. It's like, he's amazing. He really is. And he still has it, like you said. But we did that tour with him and, mainly did his hits and stuff like that. But he was always a fan of our group. We used to play a little club in L.A. about 10 years ago. Maybe it's longer than that, 15, almost 20 years ago now. And he'd pop into the club and say, hey, can I sing Oh Darling with you? They're like, yeah, come on up. Let's do it, you know. So that was fun. And then we also met really early on when I was just starting out. I was with a band called Imagine. And we opened for Peter Tork. His group was playing there. I introduced him as the Talented Monkey, which he liked. I think I got a few brownie points there. And then later, we were in the early 2000s. We did a charity show in Las Vegas. And it was, you know, some famous people were there. Miley Cyrus was there. We were the band that was closing the night. And somebody said, hey, Davy Jones is here. And I said, oh, really? So I was talking to their handler and said, you know, if it's okay, Davy wouldn't mind coming up and do a song with you guys. And she said, what do you guys know? I said, well, what does he want to sing? He said, well, he wants to do Daydream Believer, but most of the bands, since it has a lot of chord changes, most of the bands don't know that one. So he'll sing I'm a Believer if you guys know it, even though it's a Mickey song. I said, oh, no. We'll do Daydream Believer, no problem. She says, okay. So I went back to the guys backstage, and we all got our iPods out, and we learned Daydream Believer. Of course, I knew it, but the other guys didn't. I said, oh, no, there's no way we're going to have Davy on and not do Daydream Believer. But that was a lot of fun. And then I got to work with Mickey.
I'm going to tell you a Davy story.
Go ahead.
Okay. Davy comes to Australia at the Malvern Town Hall, right? They had like a little convention. And I'm meeting David for the first time. So I take my 1967 Monkees poster, and he was the first one to sign it. But when I went up to talk to him, I know that the Monkees have got like a great sense of humor. So I actually wanted to tell him a joke. Like I wanted to go up to him and say, you look bigger on TV. But I just couldn't do it. He took it the wrong way.
He was so great with that, too. He came up to our microphones, and, you know, he does that bit where he's looking at the microphone up like this. We had to lower it down for him. He was so great. Such a cool guy.
Have you met Chip Douglas?
No, I never met him. He's amazing.
Yeah, he's amazing. And what happens is he did a single with him. He became the Monkees producer because Mike just grabbed him and said, you're going to be our producer, right?
Yeah, and played bass through everything.
Well, he did Headquarters and he did everything. Yeah. And then he had this name called Farling or something. Mm-hmm. He's got like a British name he put on the album, and I didn't know what name it was. I thought it was someone from Britain. That's another story. If I interview him, I'll ask him all those questions. But he actually put out a song called Steam Engine, which is one of the greatest Monkees songs. And when he recorded it, the record company wouldn't come in and pay the money to get the song. So he retained the song and the rights. But Steam Engine is one of the greatest songs the Monkees have recorded.
Yeah, I like that one. They played it in Australia, didn't they, when the Monkees came down there?
I think so, because I get a lot on these Facebook, the groups. And I keep hearing these rumors all the time, like, we're Monkee crazy. Like, I'm on Zilch and all these ones. And then I'm hearing rumors that the fights really happen in the Beach Boy Facebook groups. Like, they're so passionate about the Beach Boys, they argue all the time, because someone was telling me they got the Brian camp, they got the old Beach Boys camp, yeah. They got this camp, they got that camp, you know? It's like unbelievable. Thank God I'm more a Monkees fan like you. Now, how did you, I know you're a Beatles fan because we don't upset people, but your love of the Monkees is great, isn't it?
Well, yeah, that's why I grew up listening to my older sister's Monkees records, and then I borrowed them and never gave them back, and really the Monkees were my gateway to the Beatles. I would never have known about the Beatles if it wasn't for the Monkees. And they were, you know, I'm kind of in that second generation of fans. I watched them in the 70s on the reruns and stuff like that. But they were a huge, huge part of my life. And I wouldn't be into music if it wasn't for the Monkees running around 2 years old singing, hey, hey, we're the Monkees, and watching my Cold Gems records go around.
So. Well, see, telling that story is basically what it is. But I got to tell you my story. It's 1964 here in Melbourne, right? I'm 6 years old. The Beatles arrive in Melbourne, right? Because they had Jimmy Nicol and Ringo flew in to play the Festival Hall. So I'm lucky I'm in Melbourne. So now I'm 6 years old. I'm watching the TV. There's all this commotion. I don't know what's going on at 6 years old. Don't get me wrong. But then we go to 1966. right? And the Monkees are on TV 9th of September in the US. But the Monkees don't hit big until 1967. That's when the TV show was shown in Australia. So here I am. This is my first introduction to music, the Monkees. And I remember being in small school, right? We call it state school. I don't know what you call your small schools in...
Elementary school.
That's it, exactly. Yeah. It's state school, we call it, but you call it elementary school. You know, there used to be fights all the time. I'd go to school and go, my Monkees fan, and the older generation, or the older kids, were in the Beatles, and they used to laugh. And I didn't care, because that was my generation. Because the Beatles had moved on now to the Sgt. Pepper part, so nobody took over the teeny bopper fans. So here's the Monkees in 67. Bang, they get all the Beatles fans, because the teeny bopper fans, the young ones, don't understand the music of Sgt. Pepper and don't get it. Right. I can tell you this. I was at elementary school, and I remember it like it was yesterday, and someone had a transistor radio, and they're playing I'm the Walrus. And I thought I was listening to a station from Mars. I didn't get it.
Yeah.
I didn't even understand it. I go, this is the weirdest thing I've ever heard in my life. It was that weird at the time.
Yeah. Well, a lot of people say that. It's like, well, the Monkees and the Raiders, that's for the little kids. It's like, well, wait a minute. That's what I was. I was a little kid. Well, I'm not going to be listening to the psychedelic stuff. I didn't know what it was. I thought the same thing. I thought Walrus was weird. What's this?
No, it's true. And, you know, this is the great thing about it, right? I love the Monkees so much that I got their first two Australian EPs, right? I've got them here. And you got something there to show me in a minute.
Sure.
But Volume 1 and Volume 2 by the Monkees, they're the first things that came out with the first album, the Monkees, in 1967. So anyway, you got to understand, I'm 8-9 years old. My family doesn't have a record player. I've got the two little EPs and I've got the album. Now, the album is bigger than my head and half my body. And I used to take it to parties, and I remember this distinctly, and beg people, can you play my album so I can hear it? True story. Wow. That's a fan. Imagine carrying that album, and it's huge, right? In your hand.
And that's fabulous.
And you go to parties, and you have to beg people to play it.
That's great, man. You must have been really poor.
Yeah, well, that's the 60s. You know, like, who had money back then? I was going to ask you, what's this special EP you got there you want to show me?
Oh, well, you wanted to see some of my... Most of my cool stuff is bootlegs, but I do have an EP, speaking of plastic EP.
Yeah.
This is the Jukebox EP.
That's great. That's how they get.
Yeah, that they used to play. You know, four tracks on each side. How do you do that?
That's exactly what the EP is.
Yeah. But... So I got that, and it has the little things that go in the jukebox. So that's kind of one of my prize collections. That's upside down. There you go.
Have you seen the Monkees, the first two EPs, the Australian ones?
The Australian ones? Yeah, let me see them.
Hang on, just hang five.
Yep. I need that groovy background you got there.
Yeah, well. This is the first one, volume one. That's Australia. Let me show you. Have you ever seen that?
Yeah.
You've seen it?
Yeah, I've seen that. That's cool. I don't think I have that one. That's a cool one.
It's only Australian. And what it says is, it says, third from the Monkees, Saturday's Child, Tomorrow's Going to Be Another Day, and Take a Giant Step.
Yep.
That's volume one.
Right.
And volume two was a red one, which I'll show you now, volume two and what was on it. You just got to bear with me a minute.
No problem.
So you haven't got volume one or volume two.
So that's cool. Yeah.
Hang on.
So were they out before the record, the LP was, or was that at the same time?
No. The two EPs came out first in the album.
Wow.
And you know what? We got like Australian releases that are only Australian. Like this is only Australian.
Oh, yeah, yeah. That's a good single.
This might be the one.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Here's the second one now. Found it. So here's the second one.
Yeah.
And that's got on it, I'm a Believer, Papa June Blues. This just doesn't seem to my day, and Let's Dance On.
Wow.
So, as I said, in 1967, this is the introduction there to the Monkees, and it says a little, it's got a little write up on each one of them. And it says, who are the Monkees? They are four of the show business's brightest new performers. Their TV series revolves around the adventures of a crazy young singing guitar strumming foursome, making their way backwards, sideways, upwards, toward fame and fortune, and then goes into a description of them. That's the start of the Monkees.
That's pretty cool. You didn't mention that they were high as a kite, but that's something else. Hey, you have this? Do you have this?
What is it? You crack me up.
You know what that is?
Yeah, that's it's a bootleg. One of those photo albums, yeah?
Yeah. I got that recently. That's one of my favorites.
That's cool. You must have a lot of fans to send you stuff too.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I get all kinds of stuff from all kinds of people.
It fills
the house.
Well, they obviously love what you do, and they love you.
Well, it's not digging ditches, I'll tell you that, you know.
Well, it's good. I bet you haven't seen this, all right? I'm going to pull this out. Look at this. This was Australian, and you had to post away for that.
Oh, wow. Yeah. So that's a Magical Mystery Tour album.
Yeah, and that was released. It's an official Apple EMI release that you can only buy through exclusively in Australia by the World Record Club.
Wow.
So you can only, and look at that cover, isn't that great?
That's great. That should have been the cover anyway.
That's much cool. About the back, but the front is unbelievable. Look at that.
That's fabulous. Have you seen these little tiny records they made for those little tiny record players? You seen that? This is like...
Oh, yeah, yeah. What are they? 3 inches or something?
Yeah, they're real tiny. That's another thing I...
Where did you get that from?
Another thing I got. I got from eBay.
Oh, that's right.
Recently.
Are they from Japan?
Yeah. They made a little tiny record players, like just little tiny miniature record players. I don't have a record player to play it on, so I'm like you when you grew up.
Well, I don't play records now. I've got a son who's 23 years old. He said, Dad, should I get a record player? And I said, no, because I'll tell you, if you haven't got a top record player, you don't have quality. Let me show you this too, right? This is only Australian. It's good to show you a few things while we're on.
Yeah.
This is Australian album. You know the Beatles For Sale?
Yep.
This is the Australian version. The photos are taken in Sydney.
Oh, yeah.
Concert.
Yeah, they changed the cover to the concert. Yeah. Yeah,
yeah,
that's fabulous.
Have you seen that?
Yeah. I don't own one of those, but I've seen it. I have the EP of that.
Yeah,
I
that's
think,
right.
Somewhere.
I got the EP too.
Yeah.
That's the back of it.
That's fabulous.
Now, you know, when I went to America, I went to Amoeba Records, right? And they're changing location now.
Oh. The one in LA? In LA?
Yeah, they're changing. Yeah. No, in Hollywood. Hollywood. They're changing their location after so many years. But when I see Beatles stuff like this,
oh,
you see that?
Yeah. Those are fun.
Yeah, I bought it.
You got the Monkees ones like that? With people trying to be the Monkees in the 60s?
No, I haven't got those. I haven't got that one. Have you got the Stu one? Stu Phillips, the guy who did all the instrumental music for the TV show. Have you got that?
Yes, I have that one. I'm also collecting some of the Monkees ones because I think they're very funny. I also have a lot of Monkees stuff in other languages, you know, Spanish and Italian, and just a bunch of other artists that recorded the Monkees trying to sound like them. It was very, very, very funny stuff.
I've collected that too. But you know what? I've got to tell you, because I'm a first generation fan, you probably don't know this. And I mean, I've told a few people, but I doubt that you know what I'm about to tell you, but I will tell you. All right.
All right. You tell me.
Now, you're going to understand something. In 1969, we're 6 months behind the US. We don't know what's going on. Peter Tork does the Headquarters movie. Then he does 33 and a Third.
Yep.
Then he leaves the group. Here in Australia, we still love the group, and we don't know what happened, and the Monkees just go, boof, they've gone. And no one knows what's happened to the Monkees. I didn't even know that Peter left the group. So here I am, 11 years old, and I get this album. The first greatest hits, right? You can see it's RCA.
Yep.
Right, because RCA handles Australia. So here I am, 9 years old, to get this. The first thing I say is, and you would too, Why is there a big black space here? And where's the monkeys? There's no picture. I'm used to a picture on the records. Why is it blank? Does that make sense?
Now I know, yeah.
No. But what makes sense is this. Here I am now, a baby boomer, and I don't want to say my age, right? But 5 years ago, I find out about this.
Ah, that makes sense now.
Now, this one is made in New York, and that's the original one. And it got as far as New Zealand, and they pulled the plug. And my guess is the reason they pulled the plug is so that because Peter left, they didn't have to pay money to Peter Tork in royalties because he's left the group now.
Right.
So when you discover something like that, and you're basically a child, and you're in trauma, what happened to my favorite group? Gone. And I didn't even know they stopped. and then we didn't hear from them till 1986. That's the truth.
Yeah. Yeah. I was there in 1986 at the Greek when Mike Nesmith joined them on stage.
Tell me how great that was.
It was fantastic. Well, I'd seen the concert the day before, and I didn't have tickets to the next day, and the rumor was that Mike was going to be there. So we went and we waited for these last-minute tickets that they released. So I got a single ticket in the 12th row, and I was there. It was amazing. Goosebumps. Place went nuts. It was just great. Yeah.
Everybody loves the Monkees, and the great thing is we miss Peter and we miss Davey, but Mike and Mickey are writing a new chapter. And I've always said this. Tell me if I'm right here. Mickey said he never left the group, which I believe him. They did changes, him and Davey, and then he said he never left the group. And I say this, I just like saying it. Had Mickey put out an album and called it Mickey Monkey or Mickey the Monkey, right, and put a photo of himself, he'd be collecting royalties because that would be part of the catalogue now of the original Monkey stuff.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. You call it the Monkey.
That's right. Mickey the Monkey or Monkey the Mickey, whatever. So you're like, get it?
He could have done it.
All the time because I would have done it.
He did. I would have done it. He did great for himself, though. He did all right.
Yeah, but even if it bombed, at least you put it out.
Yeah.
Here's the other Rear Beetle one I got, right? This is like you like this. Have you seen this one?
Oh, yeah. Wow. Yeah, that's a good one. I don't think I have that one, though. I'll have to look that one up. That's funny.
Well, remember, wow. It actually shows you how to do that twist on the back.
Okay. Well, there you go.
Little twist.
They look a little stiff, but yeah, that looks all right to me.
I love your sense of humor. Do you know what I got that's rare as well? Not that it matters. I'm pulling everything out because it's good to show you.
Sure. I love it.
You know Chachi LaPret, don't you?
Who's that?
Breakfast with the Beatles.
Oh, uh-huh.
He does a show, Breakfast with the Beatles?
Yeah.
You know him?
Breakfast with the Beatles, yeah. Uh-huh.
Okay. He's one of my friends, right? He's a great person. How are you there, Chachi? We're going to do something tomorrow morning together. But I want to tell you, he's Wings Over America.
Oh, yeah.
From 1976. But get this. Never been played.
The records have never
been played. And you know what else is in here that's great? I've got the original poster, and you're the only person to see it, and I've never opened it.
Wow. Yeah. I had that in my room. I scratched mine all up and played it a million times and put that up with my Beatle posters and my Monkees posters.
I've got the original poster never been seen or opened. This is the first time I'm actually opening it since 1976.
That's nice. You got to smell it. You know, there's nothing like smelling a new album.
I've heard that before.
Yes. Nothing better than that. That's fabulous. Look at that. You should make that your backdrop. Make that your backdrop next time.
Frame it.
Yeah. That's cool.
I gotta ask you, Ron. It's
sure.
A bit dark where you are there.
Yeah.
Have you got a light you can turn on?
Well, it's getting late. I got this. Does that help? Yeah, that helps.
Oh, man, we can see you.
We're going to talk all night, Plastic. That's going to be the problem. What time is it over there? What time is it over there?
It's only 1 o'clock in the afternoon. I love these LA interviews. I'm not lying now. I love these LA interviews where I'm up at 4 a.m. and I interview people. But there's only one problem, and I don't want to say too much, right? You don't want to go driving the next day in case you fall asleep at the wheel. It's like, you know, it's getting like that. You have to be careful out there on the road.
Pretty crazy. Crazy times. Hey, you know,
tell me this. Have you got one of, people are going to love this. Have you got one of these? I tried peeling it, but there's nothing underneath. You know what I'm talking about.
Oh, yeah. No, well, I don't have a butcher, but I got plenty of yesterdays and today.
You got the same cover?
Yeah, yeah.
You've probably got an original Sgt. Pepper album too, have you?
Oh, yeah, somewhere, yeah. My vinyl collection, you know, it grows and depletes depending on what's happening, but yeah, I got an original Pepper.
Now tell me, how did you form the Fab Four? I'm very keen to know that.
Well, how long do you got?
That's all right. Just give me the short version. Who did you meet first?
I saw Artie at a Beatlefest, Beatles convention here in L.A. And he was playing with a band. He wasn't dressed up as Paul McCartney or anything, playing right-handed. And he played a song called Coming Up. You know Paul McCartney's Coming Up?
Yeah,
and literally, he opened his mouth. He sang that first line. And a chill went all the way down the back of my spine, all the way down my arm. And I said, this is amazing. This guy sounds just like Paul McCartney. Well, the following year, his band won the contest. And I think the following year or the year previous, I can't remember, I actually won it, that same sound-alike contest. There you go. That same sound-alike contest.
It's on this album. You know that.
Yeah, yeah. I was singing. Yeah.
Coming up. And you know that's me. I've never played that.
Oh, there you go. Doesn't that have a poster too? That one's got a poster too, no? Yeah.
Has it got a poster?
I think so.
Oh, God, gotta have a look.
Mine does. Mine did. But anyways, that's where I met Artie. I met Artie there. He was singing. And a few years later, we started the group together.
That's fantastic. And you know how many shows have you done with the Fab Four being an original member because you formed it?
Too many. I think I actually hold the record for singing Imagine more than any person in the world. I mean, you know, we'd do at least three shows a week, if not full week runs. Every single night, we'd be singing those. I've been playing for 22, I want to say. I don't know. I don't keep track.
You help them handle business affairs now, yeah? You look after the
Well,
something like that, or?
Well, you know what happens is the same thing that happens in every other band. When you get together, you're just a garage band, and the four of you are standing there, and they say, well, we need a manager, and the other three guys took a step back and left me standing there like Mickey and his drums. But that's
right.
That's exactly it.
Exactly.
I didn't know anything about management. I still don't. But now we have managers and agents and stuff like that. But at first, someone's got to do it. So I ended up doing it. Not that I'm any good at it. You know.
That's great for you. You know what I mean? Everything's experience. And I mean, I've seen your videos of you doing John. And I was fortunate enough that 6 years ago, I was in Las Vegas. And I actually saw the Fab Four perform. And I saw you perform.
Oh, do you want your money back? I might have some.
No, but I got to tell you, no, I don't want my money back. But I've always been a fan of the Fab Four since you started. And that's from here in Australia. So, I mean, you know, when you're on top of the tree, you're on top of the tree. And you guys are on top of the tree. And I got to tell you what really impresses me, okay? I spoke to Artie, and I told him about your Christmas songs that you put out.
Oh, yeah.
Christmas CDs and whatever, Hark, and all those songs. And he said, you handled all that. You came up with that idea and you wrote the songs. I got to tell you, and I'll take my hat off to you, I love them. I love the songs. I love the way you do it in the Beatles style. And every Christmas, I watch it on YouTube because I know my CDs are coming from George, right?
Yeah, he's got some. He'll send you some, or Artie will. I don't even have any. I was looking around. You said you wanted to do this thing today, and I don't even think I have any, or I would send you one. But I appreciate that. They were fun. Again, same sort of difference. We had a meeting with the record company, and somebody in the record company, it was a cheap label kind of thing, the thing you see at the supermarket, $3 or something. They had Christmas records, Elvis and the Beach Boys and whatever, and every year they put a different cover on it and sell you the same product again and put the songs in a different order. They said, did the Beatles ever releasing a Christmas song? And I said, not really. I said, could you do some? I said, well, how many some? And they said, 20. So I said, I don't know. I don't know how to do this. But on the way home, I thought of the one that goes with When I'm 64 and Santa Claus is Coming to Town. And I thought, well, if I can think of 19 more, I think we'll do it. I spent the rest of the night thinking of most of them. And it was fun. It was an interesting project. Once we got the swing of it, it started to kind of get better and better. So it was fun. Everybody contributed, but I mainly arranged, you know, did the arrangements. So,
which is the one that goes to our sort of standing there?
That's Rudolph.
Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, yeah. Isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, that was fun.
You know, the Beatles put out Christmas messages and little songs, and they put them together like on a thing. That's what they did for their fans. But yep. What you did is unbelievable. But I got to tell you, I mentioned this once to you before. That Havanagila.
Oh, yeah.
Little clip on the net, they got to find it. That guy that put it together, that is one of the most funniest and amazing things I've actually seen.
Yeah, it was fun. We were actually in touch with that guy in the beginnings of his project, and I actually helped him write a few of those lines. The "Cut the crap, you're from Orange County," that's my line. And there's a couple of others in that clip. In that
What's
whole
his name?
Little,
David something.
David, uh-huh. Yeah, David King or something like that.
Something, anyway.
I haven't heard from him in a long time. He was fun. He's a real creative guy. He told me he had that version, and he played it for me, and I thought it was just fantastic.
I got to say something that people don't know, Ron. I was fortunate enough to FaceTime you before the interview, and I'm driving along in the car, and then I noticed, right, that you're on Messenger, so I pull over, get FaceTime, and give you a quick tour of an Australian street.
Yeah,
and
plastic.
I'm on my way to the record shop because I want to check out all the records and so forth. And I said, listen, when I get there, I'll FaceTime you and give you a tour of the store. And we did a tour of the store FaceTime. That was funny.
That was great. I asked you to ask for some Paul Revere and the Raiders and see what they had. The guy looked at you like you had three heads. But we don't have many record stores around here anymore either. So that was really cool. It looks like a nice big one. Are you going to buy me that Beatles display that they had? That was really
that
nice.
That guy's got posters of the Beatles from an ABC TV show, right?
They don't sell anything there.
You know what the best thing is? You get something and you make it yourself. Like, let me give you an example. Okay, I found a picture of the Monkees that I love. I love it. So what I did is I went and did the photo and I put the Monkees on it and I framed it.
That's nice.
That's very nice.
And that's for me, right? That's for me.
Actually, you know what? I've got a few of them. I can send you one.
Okay, I'll trade you. Christmas CD.
No. You don't have to trade anything. And get this. I should be able to send you the Monkees EP 1 and 2, Volume 1 and 2. I should be able to do that.
Wow, that would be amazing. Thank you so much.
It is.
Oh, look at that.
When they toured, I just want to get the color out, right, because of my beautiful background here at the back.
Right.
Oh, yeah, it's got... Even they're in more blue colorful. There in the middle instead of pink. What happens is they were selling this for $50 Australia when I went to the concert, Mickey and Mike, and I thought, I'm not going to let that go, so I got that straight away.
That's nice.
That is nice. And also, one thing I've got to say about Mike, he's got his video ranch where he sells all his stuff, and they got very good things there that you can buy. And I actually bought Mike's book. He had that Infinite Tuesday, and it had the old cover of a monkey. Then what he did is he redid the cover.
Oh, that's nice.
So what he did is he signed the book, and look at that. He personalized it to Daniel. You can see that.
That's nice.
But not only was he nice enough to do that, and I didn't ask him, but this is how much he cares about his fans, right? When he sent the book and being signed, he also sent this. A sheet that's a cover sheet of what the book cover is, and he signed that as well.
I mean, that's beautiful. Nice is that? That's beautiful. That should have been the cover.
Yeah, you've got to keep an eye on what's on Video Ranch. And also, I purchased this. I don't know if you know about this, but this is great. It's just come out now. All of Michael Nesmith's albums on CD.
That's fabulous. Look at
You're
that.
You're a Mike fan, aren't you?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. For sure. So it's got all the albums in there, huh? Yeah.
He's giving you a salute there, Ron.
All right, Nias. Good on ya.
Now we'll get off mic and we'll talk about the Beatles a little bit. Have you got more of a Monkees collection or more of a Beatles collection or a bit of each?
Kind of a bit of each.
What's your favorite item that you got? If there was a fire in your place and you had to grab one item to go out with, what would you grab?
Well, Beatles, I'm kind of famous for having I actually have a very exclusive set of proof sheets. So, you know, when the photographers take their pictures and they lay them on a thing and they make big proof sheets. Do you know what a proof sheet is?
Like, yeah, I know what it is.
Yeah.
And they pick out what they want and they do little lines to square it and whatever they
right.
do. And write numbers or put an X through it and wreck it. Yeah.
That's right. And you know there's some on the White Album? On the
yeah.
White Album poster? You know the ones?
Yep. I know. The one that folds out and opens and you see the proof on it. Yeah.
Yep. You see those proof sheets? You know where there's holes cut out? I own the rest of those proof sheets. I actually own those. So it's really
so
neat.
So is there any other copies or that's it?
What's that?
There's no other copies of the proof sheets? Just you
no, know? this is the one they cut out to make the poster with. And I have a whole bunch of other proof sheets to go along with it. About a little over 300, 350 of these proof sheets from all eras of the Beatles. That's my prize collection. And that's what I definitely have to leave because it cost me a pretty penny to get them. But I definitely have to take that before the dogs. Sorry, you guys.
I don't want to get into the nitty-gritty
with the dogs.
I don't want to get into the nitty-gritty of how you got them. But how did you come across it? Was it an auction or through a contact?
Yeah, it was an auction. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
Obviously, the money was flowing in from the concerts, and you wanted to spoil yourself.
Well, you know, we looked at it as an investment. I think they're worth about at least 4 times more than I bought them for, maybe 5.
So yeah, I don't doubt it.
They're really cool.
There's Beatle people, they're crazy. They'll pay anything for anything. Even like, you must have a big guitar collection too.
I do. I'm not as bad as Artie, but most of my guitars were for the show, so I usually don't even have any guitars here. I got a couple hanging on the wall just for fun. But and I buy some of those Chinese ones too, just for fun, just because they're cheap. But I do have a lot of guitars. But Artie's the guitar collector. He's got
gotcha. Well, you got a few Rickenbackers, haven't you?
Yeah, but they're mostly with the cases that the guys play. So I don't get to see them that often, except if I do a show here or there. So,
Ron, I got to say it's been a fabulous interview.
Thank you.
And what I want you to do is I want you to tell me now how they can find all the stuff on the Fab Four, links for yourself or web or whatever. Just go through everything, you know, where people can keep in touch about the Fab Four and what they've got coming up.
Sure. The main thing is thefab4.com. That's thefab4.com. You have to put the word the in front of it. And pretty much everything is there. Our Facebook, you know, Twitter and all that other stuff. I don't do any really much of that stuff. But thefab4.com is our hub. We did our first live stream what was that, about a week ago or so, and didn't turn all that great, but we're going to make it a little bit better. I think we're doing a new one coming up here in a week or two, another live stream, and we're going to make this one a request show, so I think we're calling it Love Songs. So if you have somebody, you have a Beatles song you'd like to request to a loved one or somebody in these crazy times, I think that's what we're going to do. We're calling it All We Need Is Love, and so that'll be the next thing that comes up for the Fab Four.
I can't wait. I saw you at the live show. I also want to say, look, you guys, Fab Four are on top of the tree. That's what I say. The world's best Beatles tribute band. And I say that with no mistake.
The banana tree.
The great thing is other bands coming up. I'll give you an example. These people are my friends. American English, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Studio 2.
Mm-hmm.
All You Need Is Love from Canada.
Yep.
These guys are all great, and they play great, and they sing the songs great, and I'm just saying, have you got any advice for anyone coming up? Because Artie just said practice, practice, practice.
Well, that's good advice, and listen, listen, listen is another thing. You know, if you have a love and a passion for it, yeah, I would say stick at it. You know, after all these years, I still learn something. There's still a little note or something I never heard before, and it's always a challenge. Every single note, every single chord, you think you have it, you go back another couple weeks later and learn that you weren't playing it 100% correctly. So that's what I would say. You know, focus in on the vocals. The vocals are the hardest thing.
And also got to say something, Ron. I saw the video of when you were retiring from the Fab Four, but obviously you're not fully retired. I saw the speech you made in front of the fans, and I'll tell you, that was so heartwarming. It was unbelievable. It just shows how much you love the music of the Beatles, and you love the Fab Four, and you love your fans. And that's what came across. And I was really, like, blown away. Because as I said, I've been a fan of the Fab Four from when you started, and I'm here in Australia. So that's how big you guys are, and that's a fact.
Well, great. I really appreciate you leading the charge out there.
I am.
It really is. It's the greatest job in the whole world. You know, I get to meet my idols like, you know, Mark Lindsay and Mickey Dolenz, and I get to play the greatest music of all time. And like I always tell people, you know, when we're on stage, we're four of the most famous people that ever walked the planet. But off stage, we're just this, and nobody knows who we are. So we get to take it off. So that makes it doubly good, you know. So.
Well, that's all right. You saw me today without my glasses. And what's the first
thing
you
saw? Hold on. Blaster KP, coming to you from Australia. We got Ed Sullivan. He's going to do some imitations for you.
Hey, you're as loud as me. You know what's funny? The first thing you said to me on FaceTime is, where's your glasses?
Yeah, because I've never seen you without your glasses. So that was cool.
Don't worry, we'll keep it. Anyway, listen, Ron, it's been fantastic talking to you. It's not the first or last time we're going to talk. We're going to stay in touch.
Yeah, next time I'll play some monkeys for you.
Yeah, next time, please. Can you play a bit? Yeah, of course.
What do you want? What do you want to hear?
All right, I want you to do the Plastic EP monkeys test. Are you up for it?
Okay, let's do it.
All right, here we go. I'm going to name some songs, and we'll see if you bomb out, all right?
All right.
Play me like a verse and a little bit. Last Train to Clarksville.
Oh, that's easy, though.
Take the last train to Clarksville and I'll meet you at the station. You can be here by 4:30, cause I made your reservation. Don't be slow. And I don't know if I'll never come.
Give me a hard one.
Alright. I'm a believer, but not so loud. Aww. It's booming here.
Is it loud?
Yeah. Just go back a little bit. Yeah.
Okay, how about that?
That's great. Yeah, all right. I'm a believer from there.
Come on, give me a hard one. Those are easy.
All right, now we're going to start getting harder, all right?
Go.
Tomorrow's going to be another day. I love that song.
Oh, man. Okay, I think it's in G, but I think you stumped me. Give me another one.
No, have I bombed you out on that one?
Backed up all the pain.
Yeah, that's
it. I'll keep it in my heart. I'm going to catch me the fastest train. I'm going to make me a better start. Tomorrow's gonna be
another
day.
Hey, 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 hey,
hey. Give me another one. Yes. Okay, this is getting good now. The kind of girl I could love. Magnificent song.
The kind of girl I could love.
you go.
Hey, you know what? So far, you haven't bombed out.
All right.
And you know what I'm going to do now? Just hang on. I know all the songs, all right? I'm not going to ask you to play like Annie Griselda. No, don't play that. Don't play it.
She knows her mind, all right, your Auntie Griselda. She says she knows my kind, she might maybe so. Oh yeah, she's raised you right, your Auntie Griselda. You only know the things she wants you to know. She's having a fit. She doesn't like me a bit. No bird of grace ever lit on Auntie Griselda.
There you go.
You know, that's amazing. I'm not your stepping stone. You play so great. In between because I didn't want to make it boring. You know, I could have got a job with a Fab Four, I'm sure.
No, you could. You could. You seem just as out of tune as the rest of us. Sounds real good.
Now,
what else do you want? Come on. Give me another
fantastic
one.
I love
Come
it.
On, give
Saturday's
me another one.
Child. The song that was going to be the number one single, first released was Saturday's Child, and then they did Last Train to Clarksville, so they went for that song. So let's do Saturday's Child, written by David Gates.
Woo-hoo! Hold on a minute.
You're on a roll, man. I'm just telling you.
Unbelievable,
do you know anything from the head?
Thank you.
words messed up.
Give up your secrets and let down your hair and sit with me here by the fire.
That's hard to do. I got this chord here.
Nah, that was beautiful. I'm gonna ask you now. There's a band. That's what I was gonna try.
You
know, you never failed on one song. Not one.
Well, you owe me money then.
We could do this all day. I'm going to call one more out and we'll call it quits, all right?
All right.
All right. Because I love them so much now, I've got to make up my mind. Oh, yeah, I know the one I want. And my kids love this. What am I doing hanging around? Even though Mike didn't write it, this is a great song.
Woo! Oh, all right. Here we go.
Just a little mouth if you went down there and go. I didn't have much time to spend with all the girls, so there I'd like you to get advantage of a girl who loved me so. But I found myself to thinking when the time had come to go.
Goodbye on that clip. Have you seen that? Hey, John, that's the best entertainment I've seen. Where's the balance number? Let's go for it. We're on a roll. Keep going.
No, go ahead.
Just stay.
It's getting late. It's getting late.
All right, Ron, I can't thank you enough. Say goodbye to all the Monkey fans out there, the Fab Four fans, Mickey
Dolan,
Mike Nesmith, everyone associated with the Monkees. It's been a blast. I've loved it.
Take care.
Take care. Bye, Ron.
Bye.